This video explains the purpose of service catalog variables and provides a brief overview of the variable types, with a more detailed look at some types. Link time codes for these topics appear in the YouTube description for this video. Service catalog variables capture and pass along information about the choices a customer makes when ordering a catalog item. Here are some examples. The ServiceNow service catalog supports over 20 variable types, described here in the product documentation. Separate videos in this series provide details for some of these types. Here, you'll also find information about service catalog variable support on mobile devices, that is, the native mobile app, and in the service portal. Unless noted in the description for a particular variable type, all variables are supported in the service portal. Each variable type is described with an example. Let's look at a few of them. The break variable displays a horizontal line to divide the form into sections. And here's the list collector variable, which allows users to select items from a table. Some variables support specific attributes, which are discussed in this linked article. For example, here are the attributes applicable to the list collector variable. Now let's look at how variables are laid out on a form. We're logged in as a user with the catalog admin role, which is required to perform the actions shown here. We've created a catalog item to demonstrate certain variables, which we've added here. Try It allows us to check the form layout and test our variables in the platform UI. In this case, we've named the variables after their types for easy recognition. For example, here's a two-column container with these four variables inside. Then we have a one-column section with three variables. One column is the default layout. To get two columns, you must use a container. And here's another container, which creates a two-column special variables section with six variables. Here's our variable types catalog item as it appears in the service portal UI. Let's see how this layout corresponds to our variables list. We've sorted the variables by the order field, which determines where they appear on the catalog item screen relative to one another. Order values must be integers. It's a good idea to assign order values in increments of 5 or 10, or even larger numbers. This leaves room to insert other variables later if we want to. We can easily reorder variables on the form by changing their order values. If list editing is enabled, we can do it right here on the list, where the lineup is clear. The container start and container end variables define the start and end points of a container layout. We have two containers in our variables list. One contains four items, and the other contains six. Here's how they appear on the catalog item form in the platform UI and in the service portal. Let's look at the container start variable for the first group. That title, container start, appears on the form because we've selected this checkbox, and the title comes from the question field. If you want a container without a title, just clear this checkbox. The layout is specified here on the Type Specifications tab. We've selected two columns wide, alternating sides, which means the variables within the container are displayed in two columns, with the first two variables in the first row, left and right, and the next two variables in the second row, left and right. Other options for container layout include two columns wide, one side, then the other, which would appear like this on the form, filling the left column first and then the right. The one column wide layout places the variables in a single column going down the page. On mobile devices, container variables are rendered in a single column layout, with their order determined by the order field along with the container settings, such as alternating sides, or one side, then the other. The container end variable defines the end of the section. The single line text variable accepts a single line of text, including numbers and special characters. Most variables have mandatory question and name fields. The question appears on the catalog item form as the field label. The name doesn't show up in the catalog item form, but is used by the system to access the variable in scripts, workflows, and other behind-the-scenes functions. Names should make sense. They don't have to be unique within the system. We could use the same name in a different catalog item, but all names must be unique within a catalog item. The system won't accept spaces in the name, so use underscores instead. We can set default values for most variables. We can control the variable width for some variables. Some have default settings, and there are additional choices, ranging from 25 to 100% of the form width. Variable width settings aren't honored in two-column containers because the variables are automatically sized appropriately for the columns. Here's our single-line text variable with the default text, which users can change when filling out the form. The Select Box variable displays a predefined set of options in a choice list. Notice that this is a mandatory field and the current selection is None. Let's take a look at how to configure it. The type is Select Box, and here's how we made this field mandatory. In a real catalog item, this would be the question the user would answer by selecting from the choice list. And the question choices are defined here. Alternatively, you could pull in the choices from a field on a table by selecting the table and field here. For example, if we wanted the user to specify the impact of an incident in a record producer, it would make sense to pull the already defined impact values from the incident table, rather than defining them manually under question choices. This way, if the impact values changed on the incident table, we wouldn't have to maintain the choices in two different places. The updated values would be reflected in our form. And here's the checkbox for including None as a choice. If that checkbox weren't selected, None wouldn't appear here. Instead, the first option would automatically be selected. Unless we had defined a default value, which would be selected regardless of its position in the list. Here it is in the service portal. It looks very similar in the platform UI. A reference variable references a record in another table. For example, this one allows us to select a name from the user table. Let's see how this was done. On the Type Specifications tab, we specify which table to reference. In our case, it's the user table. Our reference qualifier is simple. And here's where we set the filter conditions. We've specified active is true, which means that only active users show up here. The multi-line text variable is similar to single-line text, but words wrap and the box expands to accommodate multiple lines. This one is narrow because it's a two-column container, but if the variable width were set to 100% in a single-column layout, it would be twice this wide. Here's where the two-column container ends. It isn't apparent on the form. If you want to mark the end of a container, you can insert a break variable. The wide single-line text variable creates a field that spans the form, letting users enter longer lines of text without word wrap. If we were to put this variable inside the container, it would appear just like the single-line text variable. The multiple choice variable creates radio buttons for question choices, where the user must select exactly one option. The first choice is selected by default, unless overridden by configuring a default value. If you want users to be able to select multiple options, the checkbox variable is the way to go. This variable lets users enable or disable an option by selecting or clearing the checkbox, so it can be used for single options as well. Here we have another container with the label Special Variables, which came from the question field on the question tab in the variable record. We'll look at these variables, but first let's note some help options, tooltips, and example text. These are configured on the question tab of the variable record. The example text disappears when users begin entering characters in the field, and it returns when entered text is deleted. The masked variable hides information entered in the field so that onlookers can't see it. This is useful for security when asking users to enter passwords or other private information. The URL variable accepts URL data. Yes/No questions are common on forms, so we've provided a special choice list variable with yes and no as the only options. In this case, no is the default value because that's what we defined in the default value tab of the variable record. If you wanted to present the yes and no choices to the user without either of them selected by default, you could select include none on the type specifications tab and make sure no default value is specified, which would make none the default setting. The numeric scale variable creates a set of radio buttons for a range of options, and the user selects one value. The minimum and maximum values for the scale are defined on the Type Specifications tab. Values must be integers. If you don't want the first choice selected by default, select this checkbox. This variable is best suited to a small range of numbers. For more information, please consult our product documentation, knowledge base, or podcast, or ask a question in the ServiceNow community.